Welcome to our lesson today. I'm Nyongesa. So last Thursday, I remember having taught a composition about an accident, and I went through basic composition rules. So if I say basic composition rules is what every student in class 8 should know to write a good composition. And if they are basic, it means every learner should know them. So when I talked of basic composition rules, I talked about the heading, the handwriting, the introduction of a composition, and the conclusion of a composition, punctuation, which involves also paragraphing and use of punctuation marks. So while I was marking your composition, the following came out. Most of you do not follow simple instructions. Let's begin with number one, the introduction part of a composition. We are going to begin with the introduction part of a composition. In the last lesson, I said the introduction part of your composition talks so much about you. The introduction part of a composition is going to make the marker or whoever is marking your composition to have a clue of who you are or what you are going to talk about in the composition. You realize that if you have a very good beginning of the composition, whoever is marking your composition gets appeal to mark your composition. But what happens if the beginning of your composition does not appeal to the marker or is flat? And if I say the beginning of your composition is flat, it has no expression, or let's say it has no figure of speech. And if I talk of figures of speech, your beginning of a composition can simply have a simile, you can have an expression, can have an idiom in the beginning of your composition. If you have this in the introduction part of the composition, whoever is marking your composition has a positive attitude towards your work. And now, the introduction part of a composition, just like the conclusion part of a composition, is the smallest part of a composition. You can't come up with the introduction part of a composition where you are having a whole eight lines paragraph. So for example, I'm beginning here my composition. I said the heading was an accident. The heading should always be in capital letters. Let's say my heading was an accident. This is my book. And then I'm having my first paragraph. You start from here, and then you write. You write, you write, you write, you write. You end up having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, maybe some of you even have 7 lines as the first paragraph of a composition. No. In the introduction part of a composition, just let the marker have a clue of what you're going to talk about in your composition. Avoid unnecessary things when it comes to the beginning of a composition. And whatever you do, make it be appealing to the marker. Make the marker have this positive attitude that whatever you are talking about in the composition, you know what you are writing. But if you blab in the first paragraph of the composition, the introduction part of the composition, the marker will definitely know you don't know what you are talking about. Now, that's about the introduction. Let's go to the title. I say the title of a composition should always come at the center of your composition. You as a marker, you are in a position to know the length of the heading you are supposed to write for your composition. But you find someone, I want to write my composition. Let's say my heading is an accident. And then this is my book. For example, I have my book here. And then your heading is here, an accident. So that is your heading. Your heading is coming at on the left hand side of the book. No, or on the right hand side of your book. The heading of a composition should always be at the center, and it is up to you as a learner to get the size of the title of your composition. If my composition is an accident, I'm going to gauge that in between here and here is where I'm going to have my what? My heading. So I have accident, and then you underline. Always in capital letters, precise and to the point, and then you underline. At the center of your composition. No, don't write your heading here on the left hand side, on the far left hand side, or on the far right hand side, the far right hand side. Basic composition rules. Something that every learner or every candidate should know about. Basic composition rules, like one, your heading should always be at the beginning. The introduction part of your composition should always be eye-catching and captivating. Whoever is marking the composition should have a positive attitude towards whatever you are writing. And then I talked about the concluding paragraph of the composition. The concluding part of the composition should always be written as a single entity. It stands for its own. You can mix the whole paragraph. Maybe I have my composition is of 7 paragraphs. Let's say, for example, let's say my second paragraph is beginning here. So I'm writing my second paragraph, my third paragraph, fourth paragraph, like that. I'm going to the concluding part of my composition. If I'm going to the concluding part of a composition, most of you have come up with concluding phrases in compositions. If you come to the concluding part of a composition, what I realized in your compositions is maybe some of you did not listen to the lesson, because some of you are mixing the conclusion with the other paragraphs of the composition. Like, for example, you tell me the men in blue came and carried the victims of the road accident. They were taken to hospital and I heard that some died. What a day it was. So you've mixed the other part of the composition with the conclusion. How about you just write, they were taken to the hospital and I heard that some of the victims died, full stop. And then you come and write your last paragraph, maybe say, what a day it was, ! Even if it is one single line, the concluding part of a composition should always stand on its own. You can't mix it with the other parts of the composition. Now, that brings me to the most important mistake people did in this composition, the flow of ideas. If I talk of flow of ideas in a composition, what I mean is things should follow each other in a sequential manner. For example, if I talk of flow of ideas, you wake up early in the morning. When you wake up early in the morning, you take a shower, you brush your teeth, you take your breakfast, you take your bag, you go to the bus stop, you get a bus, and then you go to school. Ideas follow each other in a sequential manner. But what happens if in your composition, you wake up early in the morning, you go to school, and then you brush your teeth, then you eat your breakfast? The ideas are mixed up. Like, if somebody is marking your composition, they'll want to know what exactly you're talking about. You end up confusing the person who is marking the composition. What you're supposed to do as a learner, let your ideas flow in a systematic way. If I say in a systematic way, this is what I mean. You are writing a composition about an accident. And I said, in this accident composition, you choose a side. Are you a victim or are you a witness? I said, if you are a victim, then you can see if you are a victim, you are involved in the accident. And if you are a witness, it means you saw this accident taking place. Now, this is what you are supposed to do. If you choose a side to write this composition, make sure you know what you want to write about. Now, if I'm going to write this composition as a victim or as a witness, definitely, let me say I'm writing this composition as a victim. I've been involved in this accident. So if you've been involved in this accident, maybe you've been knocked over by a vehicle, or you've been in a vehicle that has been involved in an accident. What you do is, maybe you took a bus to Nairobi. Along the way, your driver starts driving the vehicle at a neck-breaking speed. And then all of a sudden, you collide with an oncoming bus from the opposite direction. When you collide with an oncoming bus from the opposite direction, what is the first thing that happens when people get involved in an accident? You see, some people were telling me, and our vehicle collided with the oncoming bus. People lay the bodies of the dead victims lay strewn on the road. Now, you've been involved in an accident, like that is your last paragraph. And then your second paragraph, you are telling me the dead bodies of the victims lay strewn on the road. That leaves me wondering, there's something between these paragraphs, like the last paragraph you wrote and the second and then the next paragraph you are writing. Like, what is in between here? I want to know, when you are involved in that accident, what exactly happened? You are involved in this accident. There are some other passengers inside the vehicle. What is happening, or what are these other passengers doing? What if you wrote, Our vehicle collided with this other, our vehicle collided with the oncoming bus from the opposite direction. And then you say there was a loud bang that was followed by the shattering of glass. The bang was loud enough to awaken the dead. Passengers inside the vehicle, including me, screamed loud enough to awaken the dead. Some were like, oh my leg. Some were like, oh my head, oh my head. You see, I'm trying to explain what exactly happened in this part in the vehicle, or as immediately the accident, immediately our vehicle collided with the other bus. What most of you don't do is you simply jump to the next idea. You simply jump to the next idea without explaining what happened. Or you have these clipped ideas. If I say your idea is clipped, I mean you don't explain on it. You simply say we were involved in an accident. And I will never forget that day. Why are you not going to forget that day? You are involved in an accident. Where? You leave the marker with question marks, like, you're involved in an accident, all right. Why were you involved in an accident? Then somebody says, I was involved in, the bus fell on the road. People got out and started helping the others. Now, I want to know, what happened, especially when your vehicle fell on the road? What most learners do not understand is, for you to be a good composition writer, you must be a good user of adjectives and adverbs. Adjectives describe nouns, adverbs describe verbs in a sentence. For any situation, you must describe. That's what most of you lack. So you must come up with the correct sequence of the ideas. That's what came out in your compositions. Most of you do not know how to have the flow of a composition. Yes, you can write this composition, but your ideas are mixed. Like, you're having ideas here, you're having ideas there. Somebody's telling me, when you are involved in an accident, the victims were writhing in pain and agony. The ambulance came and took the victims to the hospital. The next paragraph, wananiambia, one of the onlookers who was standing beside the road called the men in blue, and we heard the blaring of the ambulance followed by the sirens of the police car which had come to rescue us. Good. But you remember in the previous paragraph, you have told me that the victims were carried away by the ambulance. And then in the next paragraph is when you are telling me someone called the ambulance. You see, you are mixing up your ideas. It means you don't have the flow of the ideas. In a composition, for you to flow, like sequence in mathematics, it is 2, 4, 6, 8. The same thing must happen in compositions. The ideas must follow each other in a sequential manner. The last mistake some of you did is lastly, wrong use of expressions. Now, you might know an expression, and while I was teaching here, I said, you come up with expressions, you don't know how to use that expression, you can call or you can text me, I tell you how to use the expression. But what is astonishing is that most of you did not ask. But when it comes to writing the composition, you make the mistake of using expressions where they are not supposed to be used. So some of you come up with an expression, like somebody just comes up with an expression and say, the victims were lying in a pool of blood, writhing in pain and agony. Good. And this is where they are writing the composition. Say, I woke up early that morning as I knew the early bird catches the worm. The victims of the accident were lying in a pool of blood. Second paragraph. I prepared myself to go visit my grandmother who lived in the next village. I took a bus that was driving at a supersonic speed. Full stop. The bus was on its last now. In the first paragraph, you are telling me the victims were lying in a pool of blood. In the introduction part of the composition, before even telling us if the accident has happened or has not taken place. This idea of you just plastering expressions where not necessary, should not happen. If you don't know how to use an expression, leave it. Don't write it. If you don't know how to write an expression, leave it. Don't use it. And you can always ask. Teachers are here. You can always ask. Somebody is going to help you understand the expression before you use it in the composition. Lastly, it comes to spellings. So I saw somebody say the vehicle was being driven at a supersonic speed. And I was like, okay, that is good. Supersonic speed. But now you check the spellings of supersonic. So if I check the spellings of supersonic, these are the correct spellings for supersonic, supersonic. Now, you know supersonic, right? But if it is a good expression, I like it, trust me. That's a very good try. But what happens if you want to write supersonic and then you don't know the spellings? Leave it alone. Leave the expression alone. How about you just say the vehicle was being driven fast? You better say that. The vehicle was being driven fast. That I even thought the world was coming to an end. Now, instead of writing the vehicle was being driven at a supersonic speed, like somebody was writing supersonic speed, like this. Supersonic speed. What am I trying to say? When writing composition, you have this vocabulary, it is a good vocabulary, but you don't know the spelling. Leave it. Opt for the word that means the same as the vocabulary you want to write, but this word, you know the spelling, so that you can miss my spelling mistakes in your compositions. Some of you have terrible spelling mistakes, like somebody does not know how to write ant. Somebody writes ant, the relative, as ant. People here do not know how to write where. They simply write where. Where as where. Don't make these mistakes. Simple mistakes. There are some words that you should just know how to write. Which? Where? Who? Aunt, relative, uncle. People should know how to write that. And how are you going to practice to perfection your spelling mistakes? You do spelling drills. Maybe on your own or with a friend. So that you can perfect on your spelling drill, on your spellings. Don't make mistakes, especially if it comes to having big words in the composition, that you can actually use some other words that you know the spelling. Instead of having supersonic, just say the bus was being driven very fast. Period. Nobody's going to blame you for that. Instead of writing supersonic, and then you have the wrong spelling. When you write the next composition, you just make sure you abide by what I say, by what I say. So in our today's lesson, I want to give out expressions to use when you're writing a road accident. And by this I mean, all of you, when you get back your books, you redo the composition. Now, expressions to use. Number one, I'll say, the driver's hair was unkempt and resembled my grandmother's yard broom. You are describing the driver. I said, for you to be a good composition writer, you must be in one. You know how to use adjectives. Two, you know how to use adverbs. And adjectives can either be expressions. Why? Because they talk more about, expressions can either be adjectives or they can be adverbs. Why? Because they are going to describe actions and they are going to describe nouns in a sentence, in a composition. Now, this is a driver. This is the driver's hair was unkempt and resembled my grandmother's yard broom. Now, you realize that if somebody is marking your composition, they'll just picture the driver in their head. Someone that has hair that is unkempt and resembles your grandmother's yard broom. Now, how are you going to use this composition how are you going to use the expression in your composition? Let's say you are a victim in a composition, in this accident composition. You are going to visit your grandmother. You reach the bus stage, and then, out of the blue, a bus on its last legs. If I say a bus on its last legs, I say it's an old bus. Pulls up in the station. So all the people are in the station go into the bus. You pick a comfortable chair near the window. Then you pick at the driver who is sitting in front. What do you say? On looking at the driver, his hair was unkempt and resembles my grandmother's yard broom. If I'm liking your composition, what comes in my mind is one, the driver of the bus. I'm going to picture him in my mind with his hair unkempt and resembling your grandmother's yard broom. You earn marks for that. Because one, you describe the driver. The driver is the noun in this sentence. And the driver is the one going to drive this bus. Which means if it's going to get to be involved in an accident, he is partly to blame. Number two is, we heard the screeching of brakes followed by the shattering of glass. What happens if you are let's say you are a witness in this composition? You can talk of you had gone to the countryside to visit your grandmother. You are looking after her goats along the road, reading a book. When all of a sudden you hear the screeching of brakes, followed by the shattering of glass on the nearby road. As curious as a cat, you run to go and find out what was happening. Now, or if you are involved in this accident, you can say your vehicle collides with the oncoming bus. You say, the last thing I heard was the screeching of brakes followed by the shattering of glass that was followed by loud screams from the passengers inside the vehicle. You can use this expression in whatever way. Number two, you can use it if you are a witness, or you can use it if you are a victim in the composition. Now, the victims bled profusely. What is to bleed profusely? Too much. When you are bleeding a lot, we say you are bleeding profusely. So you can say, I had a gash on my head that was bleeding profusely. Or you can say, the passenger that was sitting beside me was bleeding, and I said beside, not beside. The passenger that was sitting beside me was bleeding profusely. It means the person was bleeding a lot. And then you have number four and number three, and number four are similar. Blood leaked out of my leg like water from a leaking tap. You can use this if you either you are a witness or if you are a victim. How are you going to use this? So you can say, blood leaked from the bodies of the victims of the accident like water from a leaking tap, if you are a witness. But if you are a victim, you can say, I had a deep cut on my leg that was bleeding like water from a leaking tap. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? So you can use this either if you are a victim, or you can use it if you are what? You can use it as a victim, or you can use it as a witness to the composition. I was as helpless as an antelope trapped in a snare. This only applies if you are a victim in the composition. You imagine yourself in a vehicle that has been involved in an accident. Maybe someone who is, someone who is very heavy, is sleeping on you because the bus had collided and then fell off the road. So you can't pull yourself from underneath the person because the person is very heavy. You say, I lay there in the bus with the woman on top of me. I was as helpless as an antelope trapped in a snare. That means you didn't know what to do because you couldn't do anything. Even if you try, you couldn't move the woman. Or let's say the man. You can use this as what? You can use this as a victim. And then say, the victims lay in a pool of blood, writhing in pain and agony. So this expression applies both ways. Either you are a victim, or either if you're not a victim, if you are a victim or you are a witness. You are running, you are looking after your grandmother's goat. You run to the road where you had the screeching of brakes and shattering of glass. On reaching there, what you see makes your eyes to nearly pop out of your eyes. Two vehicles had been involved in an accident. There was a pool of blood on the road, and victims of the accident lay in a pool of blood, writhing in pain and agony. Or if you are a victim, you are going to say, I lay on the road in a pool of blood, writhing in pain and agony. So it depends which side you choose to write this composition, as a witness or as a victim. And then you have, what I saw made my eyes to nearly pop out of their socket or their sockets. You use this expression if you are a witness. You run to find out two vehicles that have been involved in an accident, and what you see makes your eyes to nearly pop out of their sockets. This means whatever you see was unbelievable, or whatever caught your sight was not good. Are you getting that? So you say, what I saw made my eyes to nearly pop out of their sockets. On the road, there were two vehicles that had been involved in an accident. The victims of the road accident were screaming loud enough to awaken the dead. And then we have, like moths towards light, the passersby flock to the scene of the accident of the accident. You use this if you are a witness, a witness. So you say you run to the road. When you reach the road, you find that two vehicles have been involved in an accident. Then you can tell us, like months towards light, the villagers flocked to the scene of the accident. It doesn't have to be passerby. You simply come up with the correct noun depending on where you are. I said you are in the village looking after your grandmother's goat. So you are going to say, like most towards light, the villagers flocked to the scene of the fatal accident. Like most towards light. What do I mean? Moths light attract moths. So these victims, if we say like most towards light, the villagers flocked to the scene of the accident. What I mean is, many villagers came to the scene of the accident, So here are some of the expressions you can use in the composition, and every one of you redo the composition, because most of you messed up. So you redo the composition, then you try and use the expression, If you come across an expression and you don't understand the expression, you can always ask. You ask me, I'll explain to you how you are going to use the expression, Lastly, you don't copy. You don't duplicate this composition from anywhere. You write your own work. Have a good day.